M. The Media Project.
Excuse me, do you mind if I join you?
When a man buys a ticket for a magical mystery tour, he knows what to expect. We guarantee him the trip of a lifetime, and that's just what he gets. The Incredible Magical Mystery Tour.
Hello and welcome to the Mental Suppository. I'm Bret Herholtz.
I'm Andrew Shanley.
Before we begin, we have a new sponsor to the podcast.
This episode is brought to you by Columbia House. How would you like to own 12 CDs for a penny?
That seems a bit too good to believe.
What are you, stupid or a communist?
Well, I'm stupid. Hey, wait! You're not going to sell many CDs with that kind of...
That's what you think, commie.
Oh.
All your favorite groups are here, like Toadkill, Debbie Desperate and the Yule Dews, Brain Fart, Tofu Death Cult, The Funky Toe Jam, and the Prince tribute album titled Purple Vein, Los Alamos and the Burnt Toes, Lucifer and the Satones, Conway Twitty, and so much more.
When you do the math, it really doesn't add up to...
Give it a rest, you rooski!
Aww.
And if you act now, you get the fabulous cover album with some of yesterday's hits, featuring Ted Kennedy.
Hey, Rob. My name is Ted. Hey, Rob. My name is Ted. Not be confused with Jack or Bobby. My name is Ted. It's always been.
Stewie Griffin.
Love is like a bomb, baby. Come on, get it on. Living like a lover with a red iPhone. Looking like a tramp, like a video vamp. Demolition woman, can I be your man?
Homer Simpson and Barney Gumble sing Bridge Over Troubled Water.
Oh, okay. One, two, three.
Make a bridge over troubled water.
Barney, you're flat.
Oh, shut up.
Columbia House. Sign up today and we'll own your firstborn child.
Now, where am I going to get a firstborn child?
And our guest today is the showrunner of the biggest little convention in New England, Northeast Comic Con. But also, he's an appraiser who specializes in pop culture memorabilia and has been on Antiques Roadshow. But not only that, he's also the writer and producer of the Beasties rock opera.
That'll work.
Top that, Michael Crawford and Andrew Lloyd Webber. Please welcome Gary Sohmers.
Aloha, kids.
Aloha, Gary. So,
Andrew, nice was television that. Before, so this is normal.
Actually, Andrew and I took part. You allowed us very graciously to record at the summer Northeast Comic Con, which was, I think, that was actually the first convention in the area to take place.
Yeah.
Yep. After the plague.
Yeah.
I always look at Northeast, and you know what? I've gone to Northeast a few times. I always look at Northeast Comic Con as that opening, opening day, like for baseball. That's opening day for me, honestly.
Thank you.
It's an amazing convention. I think we should just obviously first start with, how long have you been running this convention for?
Well, it actually began as the Northeast Collectibles Extravaganza in 1985.
Oh,
now,
wow.
That was the last century for those of you born in the 2000s. But back in 1985, there really weren't massive events where tons of fans and collectors got together and bought and sold. So having been a dealer of toys and comics and pop culture and records, I needed an event that would allow buyers of all the kinds of stuff I collected and sold to come to one place and be able to then find comic books and records and toys and other crap they don't need. But anyway, the point was is that there nothing existed. So I did it for about 2 years. And in 1986, I said to my business partner, I says, look, you know, we can get a lot of publicity if we can hire a celebrity to come here and sign autographs. Because, you know, back in those days, we actually had television networks and radio that actually talked about local stuff. So they were actually going to give us publicity. There were newspapers. I know that's hard to believe. It doesn't come in your feed, but it was newspapers that everyone would be
printed on paper.
Yeah.
Right. Paper. Oh my God. So I said, I'm asking around to friends, you know, I was in rock and roll, not really in the pop culture business, but a friend gave me the phone number of Adam West's agent.
Oh, like, wow.
Adam West. Nice. Sure, I'll hire Adam West. That was my thought. And I called the number and Adam West answered the phone. The guy had given me Adam West's home number. And I'm like,
hi.
Hello, Mr. West. Who is this? You know, it's like, it was great. It was one of those great experiences. I'm not wearing the damn costume. You know, it was like, I was so thrilled and so lucky. And he came out and did the show.
Wow.
It was the first time we did it in 1986. Adam West, $10 an autograph.
Oh, wow.
At the end of the first day, he had signed 1,000 autographs.
I
leaned over to me and he goes, oh, Gary, can we do this every week? I said, we'll see what we can do, you know? And I got to work with him. His very last convention he ever did was at our Northeast Comic Con, and he passed away a month later. And we didn't even know. He was healthy and strong, playing pinball. He was having so much fun. But anyway, that's how long I've been doing this through the stretch of these entire lives of these people that were my heroes. And
absolutely.
You know, I was very lucky to be able to work with the cast reunions when I did the Lost in Space cast reunion in 1990. And I had the entire cast except Guy Williams, who had just passed away.
Oh, man. Still, that's impressive.
The robot, the guy in the robot, all these people. It was just wonderful. You could have bought all 10 autographs for $40. 10.
Wow.
Lost in Space cast members. Literally, we did the same event 5 years later, 1995, and it was $100 for 10 autographs. Still.
Yeah.
Wow.
Amazing. So having been able to put together reunions like Lost in Space, the Munsters, Willy Wonka Kids, all this type of stuff during the 1990s, it created this entire world of events that followed and saw that, wow, you could draw 20,000 people with a cast like that. Yeah, we had 400 vendors in there all selling collectibles.
Wow.
So it was like mind-blowing that you could go there. Oh, and then eBay. Then everybody decided they could sell at home in their underwear. And it kind of crushed the business.
Right.
And followed by the stock market crash, followed by 9/11. I mean, these things, one after another, started killing our industry.
Yeah.
The event collectibles industry, Beanie Babies helped kill it. All these types of things with these falsely inflated prices.
Right.
And so it changed the whole collectibles world. So when I started and added Northeast Comic Con to it, it was because in the 2010s or tens or whatever you call those, during that time period, it was a common call to collectors that you go to a Comic-Con. I've been going to San Diego and other big events, and cool. Let's, you know, and Jimmy had just started Boston Comic-Con a few years earlier.
Right.
It was all great and fun. It was pre-corporate hitting Massachusetts, you know.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, agents got involved. Agents, you know, and so all of a sudden the prices for every talent and all the egos and everything just started piling on. And then the big corporations came in.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah. I moved out of Shriners because it was kind of like a big barn, and I didn't really like a barn to mm-hmm. be doing the show in. And we moved to Hanover Mall, which is an old Sears store, which had the old funky tile and carpets in weird places and, you know, just fun and funky. And when yeah. they said, oh, sorry, Gary, we're bulldozing it, I'm like,
that'll well, kill it.
Build another building. Good job. Yeah. Good job. And I luckily got Boxborough, who had right. just it had just changed hands from mm-hmm. a Holiday Inn to a local owner. And yeah. the local owner has a wonderful team of people. And so it was like I went over and asked, hey, you guys want to rent me the whole hotel for a weekend? And they said yes. And right now the Boxborough Regency Hotel is home for the Northeast Comic
right.
Collectibles Extravaganza. We sort of fit in there. We've learned how to fill the space, make it so it's not too uncomfortable.
Right.
I hate, like, crammed in like this. You know, there's plenty of room spread out. We've yeah. got a wicked cool environment, you know, like the psychedelic carpets, the big courtyard with all the giant rocks and the pool.
Right.
Yeah, so that's amazing.
I'm real comfy in saying it's guaranteed not boring, because if anybody's yeah. bored, all they got to do is find me and I'll show them where the not boring part is at that moment.
Exactly. And I think that's one of the things a lot of people I've talked about Northeast who have been like cosplayers or vendors, that, you know, just how comfortable it is there, and how the last, you know, even with the last convention, you know, a lot of the people who went to like the big fan expo ones felt, you know, they didn't feel safe there. It was like they didn't see people, you know, obeying the rule or following the rules, or, you know, not respecting other people's space. And that was something that was really impressive when, you know, even going to the first Northeast since the plague ended, was, you yep. know, people were very, they were very
for the yeah. November show, we're vaccine oriented,
yep.
which means no vax, no entry. You know, you've had plenty of time. Half the planet is vaccinated.
Right.
And it's so sad that people have to go out of their way to attack someone that's trying to create. I mean, I got all the flack on that internet-y thing. Yeah,
you gotta love social media.
But it's not even that. It's yeah. all people. And I say to them, really, where's the event you're putting on? Well, I don't. Oh, yeah. Excuse me. I'm putting this on for all the people who want to be safe.
Yeah.
Guess what? We don't have to wear masks indoors because everyone's vaccinated.
Exactly.
So you piss and moan, you got to wear a mask. You piss and moan, you got to get a vax. Guess what? Go someplace else. Don't care.
Well, that's one of the things that I would simply add, that your show is. It's always been family friendly. It's always been affordable. It's always been a good place to go. Entry is not, I mean, you go to Boston Comic Con, for example, and those are your competitors, and it costs so much money just to get in the door, let alone parking, let alone food, let alone all this stuff. You go to Northeast Comic Con, like I said, it's opening day. And of course you have another show late in November, which is Thanksgiving weekend, if I'm correct.
Yep. And weekend of the year.
I look at it like it's the opening and the closing of the whole nerd calendar. I love it.
Thank you. You
have a lot of other competitors. Like, you do have a lot of conventions like Super Mega Fest, Granite State, you have Rhode Island and all these other comic cons. You've been around for a while. I think one of the things that we can talk about, obviously, is just the rise of the comic con mystique, the culture that has existed in the last few years. I know you've probably seen a lot of comic conventions kind of try to do what you do on, but they're obviously a lot more expensive. But you bring some really great guests.
Yes.
And you've had amazing guests come before, and I've met a lot of them. They're just amazing people, and they're great, hospitable people. You know, just can you tell me, like, is there like a particular guest that you really appreciated coming out to your convention and meeting the people?
Well, I consider myself a producer. So mm-hmm. each person that puts themselves on top of one of these type of events is a producer. You're overseeing the talent, the entertainment, the value for the dollar, the exhibitors, the customers, pretty much everybody whose needs have to be met. the hotel, the insurance company, the security people. So there's so many needs that need to be met. I set myself up on top of this, and I feel responsible for absolutely every person's personal experience.
Absolutely.
And that's really important for anybody who's producing to say is, you know, like I can guarantee it's not boring. I guarantee it because I personally am going to guarantee it. I can, you know, so these type of things. So when I look for guests, first off that, their cost for their autograph is $25 or so.
Yeah.
You know, to me, that's really important because I don't want all the money being burned into the celebrity guests that are $90 and $100 and VIP experiences is at $400. There's no money left for the vendors. There's no money left for lunch, you know?
Yeah.
I don't need those guests. Go do somebody else's show. You can go to Rhode Island. You can go to Boston. Fine. Don't care. The other thing is the guests who like have agents that demand guarantees, even though they were a zombie in Walking Dead in 3 episodes, you know, like stay home, Mr. Zombie, play video games, you know? And so it's, we're here to entertain the audience. So I always look for talent that can have an extra added attraction to their being there, whether they're going to sing with the fans at karaoke, whether they'll do a stand-up routine, whether they're going to do a presentation about their career and teach. These are the types of things that I look for when I'm talking to them. You know? So I'm very happy to have so many guests that all want to come back, you know, because we give them that really great experience. And Andrew, you're saying like, who are my favorites? Of course, Adam was like one of my heroes and favorites all the time. But like, in July, Butch Patrick calls me 3 days beforehand. Gary, I'm going to be in the area. Can I come do your show? It's like, of course you can. You know, he's like an old buddy for like 40 years. So, I mean, it goes through these cycles of, if you look at many of the artists that return, those are the ones that, to me, I want fans to meet them. Not everybody can come to every one of my shows. So maybe you didn't get to meet Joe St. Pierre or Steve Levine or Guy Gilchrist or any of the guys that are regular. Bob Eggleton, you know, these guys are brilliant. They are the top of their field. Keith Williams and Keith
Champagne. Oh, I had a great conversation with Keith Williams.
They're wonderful humans and they're phenomenal artists.
Yes.
And they're influential. So if, and people say, oh, you have the same artists over and over again. Great. Go see somebody else who got here this time, you know.
It's or like, see the artist, what the artist has new it for work.
It's not like it's costing anyone extra to
get
it. To see any people. But again, I respect the fact that everybody wants the big names. They want them for free. They want them to all this. Having Jim Shooter signing for free last time was like a win for me because
absolutely.
It was like, Jim will only come if he signs for free. I says, how much does he want? Blah, 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 done. Make it so. You know what it was like? And this time we just got Michael Golden. I mean, that was like,
yes.
Yeah, because he quit doing shows. And, you know, I mean, that's a kind of thing for me, like Dr. Strange, his whole Dr. Strange run mattered to me. So, you know, and to a lot of people, his Star Wars covers and his things that mattered to them. So here's a chance to get somebody like that. So as you say, who are my favorite guests? My favorite guests are the ones who are really nice to people and people ask for them to come back. And if they, you know, if they
I remember being at like Super Mega Fest and they had Sam Jones there. Now I like Sam Jones. He's fine. But like he was asking for $90 for an autograph. And I just remember like you haven't been famous since like 1986.
Oh,
and
no, then he was in Ted.
That's right.
He got in Ted.
If you suddenly, had the bear, I'd give some money, but you ain't the bear.
Exactly. I mean, I was sitting there. I actually had a friend of mine put together a Ming costume for me. I cosplayed as Ming because, you know.
Why, Andrew? I don't understand. Why
you know.
He has an asset.
And so I get there. He sees the costume and he's like, yeah, sure. I'm like, he's like, you should get an autograph. And I'm like, I don't have enough money. Like, I just literally
It all into the Ming costume.
I have $20 for food. And I just remember going, oh, my gosh.
That's a problem with the marketplace of celebrities these days. They have false illusions of their value. And they've also found out that less people want the autograph. So they charge more to compensate for the fact that less people want them. It's ridiculous. I tell them, you know, somebody will pay you $30 for an autograph and a photo and it costs you nothing but a, so why can't you do that? And they're like, oh, because my agent tells me I'm worth $90 to do this. You know, I say, well, tell your agent to do this, you know? That's why they're sitting at home playing video games and not at our show.
I think that, you know, obviously the popularity of comic conventions kind of really brought up the prices a lot. And obviously when you're talking about agents and everything else like that, I remember going to Spooky World and meeting Elvira and having her autograph for like $20. And that would be, I would love to see her again. I mean, obviously.
She's at Rock and Shock all the time. She was at Rock and Shock, right? Spooky World. She's done a lot of shows. She's in the $50 range now, but you know, there's, again, the same thing. It's less demand, even though she's still extremely popular.
Yeah.
She's not on television every night, TMZ maybe. But, you know, it's the way the market works is there's what I call the nostalgia curve. And that's this curve where you're really popular, and then all of a sudden your popularity wanes. And so most celebrities figure that out after they're already on the downslide and try to compensate. Mm-hmm. I'm okay with that. I work with a lot of celebrities and giving them advice and consultation in the business. I mean, like you said, I do a lot of things. This is just one thing I do is produce these comic cons. I think that it's really important that there's, you pay an admission. What do you get for your admission at most shows? Oh, I don't know. You get a chance to walk around and spend money. Oh, that's I give entertainment. I think that it's more important for people to feel they're getting something for their money.
Right.
You know, some people want grab bags, first 100 people. Great. What about the rest of the other 10,000 that might show up to one?
Yeah, exactly.
So I try and produce entertainment. As a producer, I produced over 1,000 concerts in my history. I mean, I ran Street for 9 years running concerts there with, you know, everybody from Stevie Ray Vaughan and Eric Clapton, the Allman Brothers and Prince. You know, I know how to produce shows, and I have a history all the way back to the 70s of being producing bands and concerts and shows and playing in bands and concerts and shows. So I understand all the logistics and needs for being able to create an entertaining event. So when I go to a show, and what is there to do? I can go shopping, or I can sit in a big auditorium or in a thing and listen to somebody talk about themselves. Okay, where am I being entertained here? And even in San Diego, you wait in line for 4 hours to get into
Then
you get 45 minutes and they kick you out again after you,
you basically stay like there for like 2 hours to watch a 5-second trailer of like a Batman symbol, like, ooh, the new Batman movie's coming out. Ooh, you know.
To me, that wasn't the value of entertainment that I want my guaranteed not boring events to have. So we have music and we have magic and we have comedians.
Comedy. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, I have a comedy competition. You think you're funny? Come take my money. I'm giving
I'll take that chance. Money. I'll do it.
You gonna do it?
You're gonna won't.
I'll sign up for it. Yeah.
That's the kick in this is that eight comedians will compete to do 7 minutes each for $100. The winner by the audience gets $100. Now there's four preliminaries, $100, $100, $100, $100. But then the finals on Sunday is the four winners go up against each other, and Michael Winslow is going to be the
host. Oh, God. Andrew, you might want to rethink this.
I'll do it. No, I don't care.
If you can have Michael Winslow make fun of you, you're in good shape.
Hey, okay.
I thought it was going to be something more like, you know, Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome. You're stuck in
it. Oh, it is. Oh, no. You've got to kill. You've got to slay. How you know, the audience has got to die over this. I'm telling you. If you don't kill them – you're out. You're just soft. Anyway, you're funny, take my money.
That's the other thing I've liked about your shows is because guys, you know, you could have somebody like Billy West who might get lost at like in a fan expo Boston, who is a star at Northeast. Yeah. You know, it's just somebody who's just like a really nice guy to meet too, and a local boy.
Well, it's also they make everybody so personable there.
Yeah.
Since 1985, we've been friends. And when he got the gig on Doug, I made him a guest at my show in like 1991 at the Bayside Expo Center. Nice. Had him sitting next to Buffalo Bob Smith and Howdy Doody. And it was just so wild just to, you know. And we still talk about, hey, you remember that one? Yeah, and Adam West. which one are you? Oh, no, I'm Billy. He's Adam. You know, it was like
the West. You know, I mean, as a pioneer, I really kind of look at you as one of those early pioneers of comic conventions, obviously, not only in this area, but in just
I'm
general.
Old. I know you're saying I'm old. I'm really, really, really old.
I would say you're experienced, but anyway. Have you ever thought of like writing a book about your exploits and really kind of telling people about all those amazing stories of those celebrities that you've worked with? You know, those funny little, the things that you've done and how you produce the shows and maybe some of the difficulties you've ever faced in your career doing this?
So the whole thing about writing a book is who's going to be the agent to handle the book?
Right.
So right now, I understand enough about show business that, yeah, I've got probably 30 books in me. Yeah, I don't have a literary agent. So I have currently 3 books completed. It's just the trilogy of Beasties, the sci-fi yep. rock opera. Completed, they're fabulous. You know, again, getting an agent, getting it to the right market, it's business. It's not just, you know, I'd love to write a book and self-publish it and all 6 people would buy it that like me. You know, it's mm-hmm. that's just not what I have the time and mind for. I love talking about it because right. I can tell stories for the rest of my life. But the production aspect of producing yeah. what you guys do is a time-consuming thing. When I'm busy right now producing a Comic-Con and a rock opera that is about to – we just – Act 1 is completed. All the music – and vocals in Act 1 are completed. Act 2 is almost completed. I'm very lucky to have 3 very large stars as my vocalists, which you may or may not know.
Nice.
A gentleman named Barents Whitfield, who performed at the July show outside with NRBQ. But Barents Whitfield's got like 15 albums out. He's an incredible soul singer, and he's one of the leads. Nice. Chris Farlow is the villain in it, and Chris Farlow is a famous English rock star, 80 years old when he recorded this stuff. He's still on tour right now in Europe. He was in a band called Coliseum. He was in a band called Atomic Rooster. But his original first record in 1966 was a Keith Richards, Mick Jagger song called Out of Time, which was a worldwide hit for Chris.
Nice.
So anyway, he's currently touring with his band Coliseum, with the Hamburg Blues Band, and with some guy named Van Morrison. He's like, duets with nice. Van Morrison.
Who's who? Van who?
I think Van Morrison's with a brown-eyed girl. I'm not sure.
Yeah, yeah. Chris Farlow, to go even further back, Chris Farlow's first recording was in 1961, and a little 17-year-old kid was the engineer of it, named Jimmy Page.
Oh, wow.
I wonder what happened to him.
Yeah.
He broke up with the band in the 80s, and I don't know, everyone died. Page is still pretty good. So anyway, besides having Barents Whitfield and Chris Farlow on it, we're finishing up the final vocals, but a guy named Dave Bickler has done the leads on the other main character, and you don't know his name, Dave Bickler, I'm sure, but if you know his, but I guarantee you know his voice. He is the voice of Eye of the Tiger for Survivor. You know that song, you know that voice. He is finishing up the leads and will be done with the record, which is a 2-act record, about an hour and a half long, which is really pretty monumental. I'm very proud of it. It's great.
As you should be.
BeastiesRockOpera.com and see hear some of the demos, see a cartoon video, me and Chris Farlow singing. It's pretty good.
That's amazing.
And that's what I've been doing this week. What am I doing? We're going to get out on tour, and we're going to do halls, and we're going to end up landing on Broadway or off-Broadway somewhere.
Oh, cool.
Bring it to the Hanover in Worcester. That'd be great.
Sure. You want to be the promoter?
I'll do my best.
I know.
I'll have to find some time for between my regular job, but I'll
do it. You have a job?
Yeah, I have a job.
What's a job?
Job is, you know.
It's the same question I have, like, what's a vacation?
Oh my goodness. I just want
to
so one of the things that I really love about Northeast is just that not only the casual nature, but so many great cosplayers go to the experiences there. One of my favorite experiences was when I took my very young daughter, I think she was about 6 or 7, and the new Wonder Woman movie had come out. She watched Wonder Woman. She loved Wonder Woman. She was wearing a store-bought Wonder Woman costume. And we're at the comic convention, and there is a friend of mine, Jamie Dolan, who got dressed up as one. You know Jamie?
Oh, gosh, yes.
Just so our listeners know, Jamie Dolan is a professional cosplayer. She custom made her own Wonder Woman costume exactly like the 2017 movie. And so
those are the ones that impress me, the ones that just have the technique that can make their own costumes.
Yeah. And so
it's called film accurate. Film accurate costume, that's better for the in their world.
Yes.
And so I am walking with my daughter and she sees Jamie in her Wonder Woman outfit and she's just like
the real one. That's
her
really
face. Wonderful. Her face just like she couldn't believe it. The jaw just hit the floor. And I look at her and say, do you want to have a photo with Wonder Woman? She's like, yeah. So like I take a picture of her. And that's my favorite photo of my daughter in her little Wonder Woman costume. It's not, it's just a store-bought one. You buy it like, you know.
But still, it's fun.
But you know what? That's the beginning. That's the beginning of like cosplay.
That's the
right
beginning
there.
Of and then, $1 million spent on crafting.
Exactly.
Dad.
All foam, hot glue, you know, like staple.
I need a charge card to Michael's, please, Dad.
Dad, I need to go to like I need to go at Joanne Fabrics for some crazy fabric, Dad.
I need glue and sparkles. I need more sparkles.
But for your daughter, and all the young kids there to see, you know, somebody like that in that costume, for them, that's Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. That's Batman. That's
exactly.
Luke Skywalker, Darth Vader.
Malone does that. He's always
I'm really lucky
that I'm able to be friends with all these people mm-hmm. that actually are into that whole positive messaging
yes.
of cosplay. It's not about who's better. You know, the only contest we do on cosplay is create a character, which means we're not interested in who's the best Batman. We're interested in who's got the most imagination. And therefore, if you can come and get on stage in some unique something and then explain your backstory in like a few sentences, you can win $100. Because to me, that's where the cosplay creativity really starts, creating a new character, even if it's a mashup. I don't care. The idea is think through it. Write, be literate.
Our friend Andy.
Impressive.
Oh, Andy Sawyer, a friend of mine.
Didn't you win once?
Who, me?
No, Andy. No, that wasn't you.
No. We had a friend who went in dressed as Schrodinger's cat.
Yes, I love that. I would say that should have won easily. Yeah. That was so good. But that's the idea. I want to see creativity in costuming. So we do have a wonderful kids parade.
Yes.
Every Saturday and Sunday at noon, where all the kids get to walk through the whole place and everybody claps for them like they're stars. And to me, that's like the first experience of being recognized for your enjoyment of what you're doing. So we try to give those good positive messages, both to kids and adults who are willing to embarrass themselves dressing up as Schrodinger's cat. You know what I mean?
Halloween doesn't have to be just on the 31st.
I love comic convention.
Exactly.
All year.
I love getting dressed up. I have like, it's not a question of whether or not I'm going to get dressed up. It's like, who am I going to do?
I always go as that guy from Antiques Roadshow.
You know, that guy. Yeah.
And the flowered shirts and the orange shoes. You know him.
That's a really good cosplay. Really good one.
I know. People say I look just like him.
I like to go up to the normies when they're not dressed in costume. And I like to go, oh, hey, that's an amazing cosplay, man. That's amazing.
Yeah, I remember you worked on that one. When your character died in Earthquake. Yeah, you were great.
You're a hotel manager number 3, right?
Right.
Weren't you in Airport 74?
Right. Well, what's so funny is these days I get agents calling me about or texting me, emailing me about everything, you know? Oh, this guy was in 32 movies. Well, what was he? Well, he was a hooker in this one. He was a hotel clerk in this one, and he walked a dog past Robert De Niro in this one. I'm like, Dude, no, thank you. Go away. Sorry, but you know.
It's amazing how desperate people can be just to get attention sometimes, especially
it is, it's okay. So the cool part is we have a local guy who's been in 100 films, and he's a phenomenal magician. This is his first show. He's actually going to be – he comes to the show all the time, but he's actually going to be a celebrity guest. Signing pictures. And nice. Doing magic. He's doing four magic shows. So his name is Steve Charette. I don't know if you know him. Great magician, fun guy. But he's also, he in every TV and film production that's happening in New England, he gets a role as a cop. He's in Ghostbusters. He's in everything ever made around here. Mm-hmm. And he's just the nicest guy. So we're doing a new thing. You know, as vendors, we end at 6 o'clock and everybody runs to the restaurant. Restaurant's full. What do? We're going to do dinner and a show. We're going to have a seating at 5:30 and a seating at 6:30 of a buffet dinner. Steve's going to do magic. We have a comedian going to entertain, and we have a musical act for each show. So it's just going to be like, if you, for $25, it's all you can eat and a show. So we'll see how that goes.
And guaranteed not boring.
Guaranteed.
Dude. Oh my goodness.
I sort of been saving something because by then it'll already be announced. Yeah. But we just added a duo to the show. I don't know if you're on the internet-y thing, but there's this duo called the Harp Twins. These are two Nordic Celtic.
Oh my God. I know.
Andrew's head just blew up.
They did a cover of Metallica.
Yes.
What was it?
Sandman.
Enter Sandman. Oh my God, those two are freaking amazing.
They're going to be performing Friday, Saturday, and Sunday mornings.
That's cool.
Opening the show, and they'll be there all weekend to sign autographs and do photo ops. Andrew, what costume will you be wearing each different day for the shot with the
My goodness. Well, I'm definitely bringing – okay.
Okay, look it up on the internet. All of you kids out there that wonder why Andrew's doing this, the Harp Twins, all you have to do is look it up. It's worth it. They're just wonderful people, and I'm thankful Guy Gilchrist, who was the artist who did Nancy and
the Muppets. Yeah.
Guy introduced us to them and convinced them to come do our show. So
they do an amazing.
So much fun.
They did an amazing cover of Metallica's One, where the two of them are playing the same harp, and it's such a beautiful piece.
Now we're talking harps, kids. We're talking harp.
It's not like they plug it into an amplifier. They actually.
Oh no, it's in an amp.
Oh, I bet it is.
Oh, it goes right through the PA.
If you can have an electric banjo, you can have an electric harp.
And it's fabulous.
That's some distortion to it.
Guaranteed, not boring.
Oh,
Andrew,
God.
Am I correct?
Yes, that is guaranteed.
And this kid's will be guaranteed not boring.
He will not be able to get the smile off his face until November 20th.
Oh, my gosh. And my wife's going to be like, why are we going to this thing? Because they're talented, you know?
No, she doesn't have to be part of that. That's your personal cosplay.
Yeah, I know. I got to figure something out. Like I said, the characters I usually cover are usually like bald-headed characters. Like I've done Ming, I have Picard, I have Dr. Evil. I do have an Austin Powers along with it. So I'm probably going to have to get a hotel room just because.
Ah, you better do it soon. We're almost sold out. We offer the hotel room for $99 a night, and if you book it with our code, you get a free weekend pass for the show. So it's like that's a $75 pass.
That's a deal
included in a $99 hotel room.
That's pretty good.
Let me think. Yeah, I think that's a value.
That's
two and two together.
Exactly.
Where are my other fingers? Oh yeah.
Oh my goodness. One of the things that you have so many, so this year's lineup of guests include Michael Winslow. Who else?
Baseballs and police.
I know. Who else
Robert
is coming?
Robert Wool from Batman.
Yes.
Oh,
Robert
yes.
Wool.
Robert's great. Yep. We got Christine DeBell from Meatballs.
I saw that. Yeah.
I love her. Marta Kristen from Lost in Space. I got complained last time there weren't enough female guests. Now I got way too many male guests. What am I going to get complained about now? I have Francois Clements.
Yes.
Clements. from Mr. Rogers.
I saw that.
Oh, yeah.
An opera singer. He actually did Broadway as Porgy and Bess. I mean.
Oh, wow. That,
Lisa London from the group The Pinups, but she was also in the movie Hots, along with other, you know, whatters, you know? Those were like her, it's like 90 films. They're all like, you know, Hots. They're fun. She's funny. It'll be great.
Everybody watched that movie for the articles.
Right? Yeah, no, it was what was written on her T-shirt. That's what they watched.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. They're
right for the article.
Wait, can I read that again? Yeah. I'm learning to read. That's how you learn to read.
Yep.
We have good art, great artists like Michael Golden, Joe St. Pierre, Steve Levine, Guy Gilchrist.
Guy's going to be there. Good.
Yes, yes. It's a wonderful mix of vintage and modern and, you know, comic strips and comic books and illustration art like Bob Eggleton and Mary Ann Plumridge. They're like, you know, the top of the field in fine art of pop culture.
Well, that's the other thing that's nice about your show is a lot of the big, again, a lot of the bigger shows, a lot of the artist alley things, artists get lost in the shuffle. Whereas this, you know, people get a chance to see these artists, sort of like the old conventions of the 60s and 70s, where the artists were more, you know, up front with the guests. It's like you could go to the bar and suddenly meet Bill Finger or somebody like that.
You can have such great conversations with these people one-on-one too. Like, it's not like they're rushing you along because they got like a whole line of people too. Because that's the other thing about the big cons. It's like if you meet the big celebrities like a Bruce Campbell or whatever, there's a line like around the block. But like you only get like 5 seconds. Like, here you go, here you go, here you go.
Sometimes they even look up.
Yeah. It's like a scene out of Galaxy Quest where he's just rifling off autographs to people.
That was real, believe me. In the 90s, and that was real. Oh, yeah. In the 2000s, that was all real. But the biggest guest I got is the smallest guest I got. I don't know if you pay attention, but to me, this was the biggest get that I could get from the blockbuster movie. This current movie right now, Godzilla versus Kong, is Kaylee Hoddle.
Yeah.
If you have not seen Godzilla versus Kong, it's a fabulous movie. I mean,
I saw that.
I love it. And she's in the movie from the first scene to the very last scene. She is deaf, completely deaf.
Oh, wow.
She cannot hear at all. Her and her mother and her father are all deaf. So she is coming. And it's American Sign Language. We're going to be promoting learning and communicating with American Sign Language.
Oh, that's so cool. We're
working with an organization called the Learning Center for the Deaf out of Framingham, Mass.
My sister actually used to work there.
So you know that they do good work for good people.
Absolutely.
And she's only going to be there on Friday and Saturday. But the point is that she's going to do a presentation on stage. And we're hopeful that we can educate more and more young people about ASL, American Sign Language, and hopefully people will come and speak to her in her language. And so that's why anybody that's watching, if you are fluent in ASL, please come and say hello to Kaylee.
Will there be an interpreter on hand as well just to help out?
Yes, one of the things they've told me is that they do a lot of stuff writing down notes and passing notes back and forth.
That's good.
What's called small talk. You know, if you don't speak it, but it's just, there's standard questions. Who do you want it made out to? You know, in the autograph line.
Right.
But realistically, there's going to be a lot of people who just want to talk to her, you know, and ask questions. And a lot of that will be put off till the presentation when it's a...
That's understandable.
What's really interesting that I've always tried to put into our shows, as you'll know, is in all of our seminars and all of our panels, they're all based on one thing, careers in the creative arts, any career that could happen in the creative arts. Because I know when I was young, I was told, you know, McDonald's is hiring, you should go get a job. Don't work on your art, don't work on your music, don't work on any stuff, because that's no career.
Right.
And we're trying to say that because of Comic Cons, because of the huge, massive entertainment industry in every aspect, especially here in New England, there are jobs for everyone in the creative arts. You just have to understand that it exists. You have to learn from people who already know it, and you have to share the information when you do know it.
Right.
So one of the things you guys do, one of the things that we always do is we have careers in the creative arts programming. So mm-hmm. Kaylee will be doing careers in the creative arts programming.
Very cool.
All of our guests. Mm-hmm. Because the next big star, the next great author, the next great artist, it's going to be some kid right now. Somebody's going to tell them, you can do it.
Yep.
Do it.
And I remember when I was actually doing, I did Massive Comic-Con a few years ago. They don't do it anymore, sadly. But I remember they had an actor's studio workshop with Richard Hatch before he passed. And that was an interesting panel.
Not the one from Survivor's Kids, the actual actor.
Yeah, the actual actor from like Battlestar Galactica.
Yes.
You might remember him from another movie like Prisoners of the Lost Universe.
I know who he is. I've met him many times.
He was fantastic. but like, you know, so you have like, what are the kind of the panels that you're going to have there?
To be determined. Dun, dun, dun. You know, we're working on that because I have way more people that want to do them than I have space and time.
Yeah.
And so kind of figuring out space and time is my magic. So right now we're talking to people. What do you want to do? What do you have? What can you do? So, we have this organization from Pittsburgh that's out called, they've come out with a new book and series and music and stuff like that called Heroinburg, which is about heroines, women who are heroes.
Oh, okay.
No, awesome.
Drugs, which is hard to pronounce differently if you don't explain it.
Right.
But
yeah.
They're coming all the way out from Pittsburgh because they want to present it to a New England audience. So they're coming out and they're going to have a showcase of their product. Plus, nice. The twins will be doing, so everybody will be doing something to try and contribute to the education and growth of our marketplace.
Go to the show and find out, people.
Yeah, don't, definitely
be there or be normal.
Yes.
I know. I remember.
You will have fun.
I love going to the show because you get to meet not only the people that are like yourself, because obviously we're all nerds here. We're all geeks and everything
else.
Hey,
I resemble that remark.
But one of the things I
love
is
yourself, Andrew.
Dealers that they have with all the original old toys that they sell. And I remember actually being there and seeing one of these tables full with all the old Ghostbusters, He-Man.
Oh, Andrew tells the story a lot.
And I said to the guy, this is the place you go to buy back the toys your mom got rid of back in the day.
Yeah.
You know,
I work really hard to find the vendors that can sell you back your youth.
I know, exactly. And I remember I actually saw an Ecto-1 that was there that a guy had. It was one of the original ones. And I was like, I had this when I was a kid. And
did he tell you he bought it from your mom at a yard sale?
Probably.
If he did, that was me.
He might have rescued it from the trash. I don't know what happened. My mom did. But,
well, I probably have your youth in my garage. So
that's okay. I mean, you know, I look at the reproduction stuff that's coming out on the toy shelves today, and it doesn't have the same heart that the original stuff had. You know,
the thing about collecting toys of your youth is you have a nostalgia for it.
Right.
Exactly. It was what you touched, you smelled, you bit, whatever it was you did, that it, when they make it of a different plastic and, you know, it's like, it's not the same. So you're not buying it to replace what you had. And that's why you come to shows. That's Sector He-Man. I just picked up a slime pit. Mint in the box.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Toys. I'm going to make you so miserable at the show. That's my job.
Exactly.
Like you said, I did the Antiques Roadshow for 13 seasons.
Yep.
I'm the expert in popular culture collectibles. So I get calls every day. People want to know what their stuff is worth. So mostly my job these days is in the 3Ds. I'm in the business of downsizing, divorce, and death. So it's one of those is going to hit everybody.
Yep.
And I always suggest downsizing before the divorce or the death, you know,
yeah.
Because afterwards you don't cash in, trust me. So each cycle in the nostalgia curve, stuff keeps coming out. And my job is to help people make sure that it doesn't end up in a landfill, whether they get a ton of money, some money, or mostly doesn't land in a landfill, then it's a win.
Well, I always like stopping by your table first, you know, because first you have to sign in, but also you have all the vinyl on the table. So I'm just looking at it like, ooh, Frank Zappa, Shake Your Booty, or, you know, something like that. And it's just like, oh, you know, yeah, I always get excited when I see, you know, old vinyl, you know, especially.
I'm an old rock and roller.
Oh, yeah.
you know, and that's part of why the Collectibles Extravaganza exists as a name underneath and as associated with Northeast Comic Con. We are a Collectibles Extravaganza. I mean, in one of my shows, an Amazing Fantasy 15 went up on a shelf for $6,000.
Holy mackerel.
15 seconds later after it hit the shelf for $6,000, and it was moved over across to a table on the other side of the room where it went on the shelf at $15,000. And within about 15 minutes, it was sold at $15,000. And it went online and sold for $19,000.
Of course.
So the moral of this story is, Gary needs to be there when it's 6,000. I missed it, but we all missed it. You know, that's the kind of thing that you get in there, and if you're educated about the stuff, you can buy really well, and you can buy and make a profit if that's what you're into.
Right.
It's the Wall Street of nerds.
Come there on Sunday just to pick our bones. Yeah. You know, you haven't sold it in 3 days. How about taking $20? Sure. You know, so there's a benefit to getting there first, but there's also a benefit to being the scavenger at the end going, how much for everything on the table? You know,
Absolutely.
Andrew, bring all your money on Sunday. How much for everything on the table?
Trust me. Shut up and take my money.
I'll be dressed up as Dr. Evil going, $1 million.
All it takes.
Actually, one of my favorite Northeast memories is when my wife and I went to see Mickey Dolenz when he was appearing there. And my wife was a big fan of the Monkees, and I liked Mickey when he was on the show The Tick. So we went there, and I ended up talking with him for what seemed like a half hour just about The Tick and Harry Nilsson and Frank Zappa. I mean, it just ended up being this like really great conversation, because it's like I immediately mentioned the Harry Nilsson documentary that came out, because I'm a big fan of Nilsson, and you know, my parents were fans, and they kind of passed it down. So we just ended up chatting about that, and it was a great experience. And for my wife,
Mickey is really truly wonderful human being. I met Mickey first time in like 1977.
Yeah,
and you know, he didn't remember me, of course. I was just one of those. But sometime in the early 2000s, he had a radio show in New York City on WCBS every morning. You know, so his producer invited me down to be on his radio show when Roadshow was huge. And I was one of the Mouseketeers on Roadshow. I was on every week.
Right. I remember that.
He brings me down, and we did an hour of what I call psychic appraisals. I do radio. I do it on WBZ since the 80s. I used to do 30 radio shows a year all over the country, because I can tell you what your stuff's worth without even seeing it. I'm a psychic appraiser, which I mean, I know the value of 100,000 useless objects. So he would have me on, and I'd be cracking jokes, and Mickey be laughing, and people be calling in. They get huge number of call-ins. So I get invited back the next month, and then the next month. And so I was going down and doing Jay Thomas's show, and doing Mickey's show was a lot of fun. So Mickey had his very last show. He didn't know it was his last show, but it was his anniversary show. Ooh. And we're at BB King's and live over the radio. And he's got Jackie Mason on the show. And me.
Really?
And I was just like, so here I'm standing next to Jackie Mason. He comes up. Mickey's the sweetest guy. Gary, have you met Matt? Jackie, this is Gary Sohmers. Jackie Mason leans over to me and goes, so what do you do? I says, I guess I'm just another Jew doing comedy. He looks at me, goes, Jews do comedy? And I'm like, I couldn't say another word. I lost it. I even lost track of what I was supposed to be doing. But he was just wonderful. And Mickey's always been so kind to me. And, you know, every time he comes up, it's always a good time. He sings with fans. He sings with fans. I mean, he's such a good person.
Yeah.
In fact, they're playing here in Massachusetts on the Mickey and Mike tour.
Mm-hmm.
That's
so
right.
Let me ask you something, Gary. Okay, so you do appraisals. I got a question for you. Can you do a live appraisal right here? All right. So I have something that I just recently acquired, and I was curious about how much it costs. I'm not going to say what I got it for, but I got right here a Elvira model kit from Monogram of her original Macabre Mobile, which was a 58 Ford T-Bird.
Uh-huh. What's the date on there's a date on it for
1988.
It's an 88 version. Yeah, because they reissued it. Yep. Now, what value are you looking for? There's three values. Let's talk about values so everybody understands this. Whenever anybody says, what's this valued at? There's three different thought paths. The first one is liquidation value. What can you get for it right now? That's a value, because what would somebody in their right mind give someone somewhat in their right mind for something? That's called liquidation value. The second value is called fair market value. What would it sell for from a willing buyer and a willing seller in a marketplace like a shop or an auction? That's fair market. That means you could set any price, and if they're willing to pay it, then the customer was right and the price was right. The third value is what's called replacement value. That means if it burns up in a fire, how much is it going to cost the insurance company to get you another one? You see what I'm saying? So that's expensive, because you're paying a guy like $20 an hour to look for it, and all he wants to do is give you a Walmart gift card and say good luck.
Exactly.
But either way, it's much more. So the low price, middle price, high price. So what value are you looking for, young man?
Let's go with liquidation, and let's see the middle one. What was the middle one again?
Fair market.
Fair market. Let's see what do you think on the liquidation and the fair market value for this?
I would think liquidation for a sealed one of those is around $15.
Okay.
I think fair market would be about twice that, about $30. That means a vendor would be happy to buy it for $15 at a table in a show and sell it the same day for $30. And I think that if he had it for $30 on his table, three shows later, he'd take $25. But if it burned up in a fire, I'd ask an insurance company to give me $100 because it's going to take that much time and effort to get another one still mint sealed, because you have to pay to get to a show, you got to pay to get in, got to drive there. There's expenses in getting that object.
Well, I'm not burning down my house, so I'll just hold on to it.
Yeah, well, don't put it in your house.
That's true.
Don't burn down your house. I don't advise that.
No, never a good idea.
Shouldn't give that advice. Yeah,
yeah, no. never
only because you're not insured.
Exactly. that was incredible. Wow.
Well, I do insurance appraisals for people in the 3Ds usually. You know, they need to know realistically what can they get for it right now.
Right.
And sometimes it's like, well, if you just take it and you put it in an auction, you'll get X in 3 months. If you just sell it at a yard sale, you'll get X now. If you burn your house down, you'll get in trouble. But you know, these things are the levels of understanding people have to have. Somebody dies in your family. Say it's you and your collection. They don't know nothing about it. They don't care, most of them. Oh, well, I remember Brett showed me this. It was cute and I liked it. I'm going to keep that. What do you mean it's worth $1 million? You guys can't fight over money. You know what I mean? So families fight. Stuff happens.
And I always thought he was worthless.
Correct.
Well, I mean, recently my father-in-law died, sadly, and he died like a year ago, and so he left us a whole ton of model kits that he left behind, and of course we had to sell them all, but we kept a bunch, and most of them were of the movie macabre kind of things. We actually have like a Munsters like reissue of the, you know,
Munsters house, the family scene.
It's got the it's actually the Cars.
The Cars,
yeah. Dracula and the Munster, the one that Barris made.
The coach.
Yeah, the coach and the Dracula. We have, you know, just that kind of stuff. We have
all the modern models. Versions, Polar Lights and the.
Yeah,
that's okay. They're going for $50 now, you know.
Well, I just saw an auction. They were selling the actual Dracula.
$1,000, huh?
I just saw an auction. They were just recently selling the car Dracula.
Yeah, they're making copies of it.
Oh, it's a copy. Okay, yeah.
Which has a copy of both. We had him out at Brimfield one few summers ago, and he actually had the Dracula in my tent, and we had the Munsters coach out back. And you, for $100, four people could ride in the Munsters coach up and down Route 20 and get autographs from Butch.
That's pretty cool.
So cheap. Just for one day, and we had a lot of fun. People were going crazy seeing the Munsters coach driving up and down Brimfield.
And that was before people had like cell phone cameras or anything.
Oh, no,
like
no. What? Everybody had pictures.
Oh, really? Oh,
that's even better. This is like 3 years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you take part in Brimfield, right?
Oh, I'm always at Brimfield. Yeah. Three times a year. 36 years I've been there.
Nice. That's always an amazing experience. Just everything that's there. You know, you just can't take it in one day.
I know. So. I just sit there all week in my booth. I never leave my booth except for the bathroom and food.
Yeah.
So
what else you got?
Oh my goodness.
Show. That was
what
funny.
Else I got?
Pause. Good pause, eh? Bathroom and food. Pause.
Bathroom and food. Pause.
I think what happened is both of you guys decided you needed food and go to the bathroom.
It's like, hey, wait a minute.
Wait a second.
Clearly, we don't have as much energy as you get.
Maybe I can do it at the same time. No, that's a bad idea.
No, Andrew's doing it right now. Don't worry about it.
Why do you think he has the sheet behind him?
I'm in the bathroom. I'm in the basement right now. You know, so that's like
better than being in the doghouse.
It looks like a porta potty to me. Sorry.
Yeah, pretty much. Oh
wait,
my god.
It's a porta potty on the Orville.
Yeah, pretty much. I'm just knocking down all my stuff that I'm working on right now. I've got this. Well,
it's lucky this isn't video.
I got this like steampunk kind of thing I'm working on right now.
Yeah, you hold up a weapon on TV. Yeah.
It's got the orange tip. It still has it. It's an airsoft gun.
Sure. You say so. Said the bald guy with the headphones. Yeah. I think that's villain. Right? That's it. I've read every comic book. That says villain. I don't
exactly.
Know. I'm holding exactly. This gun with a glowing red thing. Oh, yeah.
That's not real.
That's fine.
Yeah. I don't have a giant
this
laser.
Is real.
I don't have a giant laser behind it. There's no giant.
I needed
laser.
A permit for this.
I know. I can imagine that because that's real. That looks real.
Totally.
So tell us.
Go to my website, Northeast.
No, I was just going to ask you. Yeah.
You heard of it?
Yes,
NEComiccons.com. NE for Northeast.
Yep.
Comic Cons. Plural, because we do a lot of them, .com. And or if you wanted to learn more about the Beasties Rock Opera, go to BeastiesRockOpera.com. Amazing how these addresses all end in .com.
I know.
Yeah.
No, net or org.
Conspiracy. Oh, no, it's a Comspiracy.
Yeah. It's a Comcast.
Where you could actually do it like comic.com.
Comspiracy. It's all too much.
That would be
really.
A pretty creative way. Like comic.com. There you go, huh?
I wonder who owns that. Now there's so
yeah.
many infringement. Well, no, it became a bunch
it's
of
It's probably
publicity.
Some guy in Russia that bought the domain and wants to sell it for $1 million.
Yeah.
Wait. No, you said that wrong.
Oh.
$1 billion.
Dun, dun, dun.
Why, Dr. Evil, Virgicon is worth like, does about $7 to $8 billion a year. Oh, that's a lot.
You're in it. You're in it now. The twins will love you. Don't worry.
Oh, my gosh. I can't wait. Now I'm going to have to – now we're definitely going. We're definitely – I mean
– Okay, so don't start talking
really
about –
really going now.
Nope.
Don't talk about it on the internet until after Monday.
Yeah.
This Monday coming up tomorrow, whatever day tomorrow is. It'll be announced tomorrow. So
don't worry.
Read this, all of this blah, blah.
Yeah.
But – I'll be announcing it tomorrow. You can follow, like, drool, whatever you want. See, I know the drool factor is high on this one.
Yeah, I mean, you can find Northeast on Facebook and Instagram. And are you also on Twitter as well? Or
no, we don't like Twitter.
No, nobody likes Twitter.
Twitter is cancer.
Twitter's a giant dumpster fire.
No, Twitter is MySpace.
Yeah.
It is.
It's like, oh, it was fun while it lasted, but I don't think I want to be friends with them.
I never understood the appeal.
I don't want to be friends with Twitter.
I don't understand the appeal of Twitter where you're like wrote like two sentences and that's all you could write in the first place. And then
I
they
expanded. Feel like Twitter was only a way just for people to like argue with celebrities or something. It just apparently. Didn't seem like much fun.
No, Twitter is ADHD in text.
I'm
sorry, I have to do it again. Wait, what did I say? No, I got to do it again. No, wait, what did I say? No, I got to do it again. Wait. Oh, sorry.
That's good.
Thank you. I'm doing stand-up comedy at my show, Northeast Comic Con. Come do Battle Royale, Andrew. Let's see how good you are. See if you land on the island and survive.
Is it going to be like the Japanese movie where we'll have collars on if we don't get enough laughs, we like our heads explode off our heads?
No, that's a good idea, though. I think I'll use that next year. Wait, if we filmed it, oh, now we have a show.
Oh, he,
not boring.
Did he win? No, he just lost. We're going to have to clean him up.
Another loser. Well, you only got one left. He's the winner.
But he's running away.
Your idea is really good, but we'll wait till the end of the show. And okay. You know, when you hold your hand over, if you don't get enough applause, so we'll see how that goes.
There you go.
Hey, I'm willing to take suggestions from my audience. And what can I say?
I mean, that's the other thing, too. It's such an interactive show. I mean, you make it better every single time I go. It's family-friendly. It's affordable. It's got great guests. The guests are
interactive. You must be vaccinated to come in. You must be vaccinated because absolutely. We're protecting the kids that can't be vaccinated.
Right.
Absolutely.
We're hoping they are, but the idea is if you're walking around without a mask, you're under 12. And you should be wearing a mask if you're under 12, because everybody over 12 has to be vaccinated.
Right. Or if you are wearing a mask, you better be in cosplay.
No, you can wear a mask. That is your cosplay.
That's
you're
true.
Just ugly. We accept that. I wear a mask just to keep people from throwing up looking at me. You get wristbanded when you come in, when you show your card, so you never have to show it again all weekend.
That's great.
I carry mine in my wallet, so.
Ain't no convenient.
I have a picture of it on my phone, so.
Yep.
So I'm good to go.
I do. That's the way to do it. It's so simple. I don't understand why people can't. I mean, I'll just be honest. I had a negative reaction to my second shot, but I'll go get another one. So keep.
Yeah, my parents just got their boosters, and they're doing quite fine. And Gary, please, do you get your booster yet?
I don't need it yet. I'll be getting mine in January when I see my doctor for my physical.
Okay, because everybody wants to be. We need Gary to stay around as long as possible.
It's going to take a very large, fast-moving bus to stop me.
Good. It's like, is it going to go over 50 miles an hour, though, if it doesn't blow up?
I don't think so. I think what's-her-name is going to be driving it, so I'm not worried. Bolt. Yeah, if Sandra's driving it, I'm safe. She missed me. Oh, my gosh. Oh, well, anyway.
Well, it's not like she's driving a cruise ship. Yeah. Let's
Keanu
take a
Reeves
cruise
in
ship.
Speed reading.
Speed. Yeah, right?
The next show is going to be it's going to be like one of the oil rigs.
Yeah, I think she's already done a rocket ship. I don't know what else she can do, unless we send her undersea.
Or a biplane.
All right. Hey,
but that's the Fast and the Furious franchise.
Story. Yeah.
Fast and the Furious next movie is going to have a drag race on Mars. It's just going to have to happen.
Yeah. And it happened in the past. They'll figure that out.
Oh, probably.
Fast and the Furious in the Old West.
In the old hit, right. Well, what is that Doc Brown doing with that train? Well, I could beat him off that cliff. Weird references. We'll see how many get it. Thank you for watching.
Oh, man. I can't wait to show now. I really can't. It's going to be so much fun.
Guaranteed not boring.
Just like this podcast is definitely guaranteed not boring either.
Especially this episode.
Yes.
Did we do something serious here? I think I did.
I think they think, but mostly it's just been a heck of a lot of fun just having you on.
This has been a great interview.
Yeah.
It's been great.
Hey, it's what I do.
Yep.
All right, guys. Thank you so much. I hope you have a wonderful week and stay groovy. Northeast Comic Con, NEComicCons.com. Guaranteed not boring and free parking. These guys will be there.
We'll be there.
Yep. See you there.
All right. Aloha.
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 I'd like to thank our guest, Gary Sohmers, for stopping by. And check out Northeast Comic Con on Thanksgiving weekend in November. On behalf of Andrew, thank you for listening to The Mental Suppository. Until next week, this is Bret Herholtz saying,
I knew I'd disturb you.
The Mental Suppository has been produced by Bret Herholtz and Jamie Billings and distributed by M The Media Project. Theme music generously donated by Mr. B, the Gentleman Rhymer. Visit his webpage at gentlemanrhymer.com. We would love to hear from our fans. Email us at mentalsuppository@gmail.com.